morning.
Take a moment and welcome those next to you. Our order of worship this morning is the order of Matins on page 219. We begin by singing hymn 616. O Lord, open my lips. Make haste, O God, to deliver me. Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The psalm is printed in the bulletin. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. In the company of the upright, in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in him. Full of splendor and majesty is his work. His righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered.
The Lord is gracious and merciful.
He provides food for those who fear him.
He remembers his covenant forever.
He has shown his people the power of his works,
in giving them the inheritance of the nations.
The works of his hands are faithful and just.
All his precepts are trustworthy.
They are established forever and ever, to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He sent redemption to his people.
He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever.
You may be seated. The Old Testament reading for the 18th Sunday after Pentecost is from the book of Ruth in the first chapter. And in the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi, and the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. These took Moabite wives. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other, Ruth. They lived there about 10 years, and both Mahlon and Chilion died, so that the women was left without her two sons and her husband. And then she arose with her daughters-in-law to return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the fields of Moab that the Lord had visited his people and given them food. And so she set out from the place where she was with her two daughters-in-law, and when they went on the way to return to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, "Go, return each to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. And the Lord grant that you may find rest, each of you in the house of her husband." And then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voices and wept. And they said to her, "No, we will return with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters, go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, even if I should have a husband this night and should bear sons, would you therefore wait till they were grown? Would you therefore refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, for it is exceedingly bitter to me for your sake that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me." Then they lifted up their voices and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. And she said, "See, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. May the Lord do so to me and more also, if anything but death parts me from you." And when Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more. So the two of them went on until they came to Bethlehem. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. epistle is from 2 Timothy chapter 2. You then, my child, be strengthened by the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, and trust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits, since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. An athlete is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. It is the hard-working farmer who ought to have the first share of the crops. Think over what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David, as preached in my gospel, for which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal. But the word of God is not bound. Therefore I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is trustworthy, for if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We rise for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 17th chapter. And on the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said to them, Go and show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? And he said to him, Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well. This is the gospel of the Lord. Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. You may be seated as we sing hymn 846.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text is the gospel which was just read. This gospel passage from Luke 17 often appears as the gospel during Thanksgiving. It teaches us to be thankful, and it begs the question of what are you thankful for? Are you thankful for your body and soul, your eyes, your ears, all your members, your reason, and all your senses? What about clothing and shoes, house and home, food and drink, land, animals, wife, children? What about good health or improving health? For faith, a job, retirement maybe, the freedom that we enjoy as Americans. For all these things, it is our duty to give thanks and to praise God. Now, sometimes when we do something, we don't always get the appreciation for it that we think we deserve. We're disappointed because not more people appreciate the job that we've done. And Luke records an experience like that happened to Jesus. Today we hear of 10 lepers who've been miraculously healed, but only one returned to give thanks and praise to Jesus. Only one remembered where this healing came from. And Jesus asks him, probably with disappointment in his voice, where are the other nine? How often we are like those other nine. We forget to say thank you for the wonderful gifts which we've received from God. We forget that even in the midst of our trials and troubles, we still have much to give thanks for. How often do we fail to see the positive because we focus so much on the negative? It's fitting that we should give thanks and praise for God's wonderful gifts each and every day of our life. The nine who didn't return to thank Jesus, they did have faith in him. They all cried out, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." The NIV version says, "Have pity on us." It's a prayer for salvation, a cry that encompassed all of their needs, not just the release from the leprosy, but release from all uncleanness, an end to their separation from their families and friends. All 10 lepers knew what they needed, and they all saw Jesus as their only hope. And Jesus responds to their cry. He tells them, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." He sent them to the place where they would be declared clean. They would be released and able to return home in every sense. Yeah, there's no doubt that the 10 believed in Jesus. With the evidence of their disease still visible on them, they got up and went to show themselves to the priests. And it's on the way that all 10 of them were healed of their leprosy. No doubt they were all rejoiced and happy. All 10 had their lives changed by Jesus. But only one of them remembered who it was who had healed them. Only one of them, an outsider to the Jewish people. Only a Samaritan, a person looked down upon as inferior by the Jewish people because they had mixed marriages with the Samaritan people during the captivity in Babylon. Only one comes and returns to Jesus and gives him thanks. He rejoiced not only in a healing that made him part of the community again, but also in the healing of all his sin. He was now reconciled to God, for he had received the forgiveness of his sins and given a new life. That's what that healing meant to him. The Samaritan leper's prayer for salvation, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us," is fully answered. And Jesus tells him to leave his worship, to continue in the journey of faith. He tells him, "Go. Your faith has made you well." The salvation he prayed for is now his. Many people give thanks for material blessings. Even you and I sometimes find ourselves weak, though, when it comes to thanking and praising God. We tend to be much better askers than thankers. "God, please perform for us, feed us, smooth things out, defend us against our enemies, make us happy." Too often, we expect God's promise to feed us. We fail to ask for our daily bread. And if we do ask, we fail to thank God when we do receive it. More often, we complain that what we get to eat is not what we wanted. We want steak, but instead are given hot dogs. Like the Israelites of old, we're tired of the same old thing. We want something new and wonderful. And even when we get something new, we fail to thank God for it. We have lots of reasons to give thanks. Consider again the 10 lepers from the gospel. Jesus healed all 10 of them of an incurable disease. But only the Samaritan recognized the healer behind the healing. Only one of the 10 recognized the giver behind the gift. He believed not only that God had healed him, but also that this God is Jesus of Nazareth. The foreigner believed. He returned to thank and praise God, and his thanksgiving flowed into worship. Jesus may not have healed you from leprosy, but he's healed you from something infinitely worse. Jesus Christ died on the cross to deliver you from the diseases of sin, of death, and of the devil. You and I, who suffer from the mortal disease of sin, have been healed. In the waters of holy baptism, applied to each one of us, God calls us by name, sets us on the journey of faith, and heals us of what we need most, forgiveness of our sins. That alone is more than enough reason to return and thank and praise God. And that thanks and praise flows out of worship. We gather today in worship around God's word. Sometimes we gather around the sacrament that we call sometimes the Eucharist. The Eucharist is nothing but a Greek word that means thanksgiving. We're thankful that we have the time to thank God for what he has done.
as we partake of his body and blood, we give thanks for his sacrifice on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. We give thanks for all the good gifts God has bestowed on us. And in gratitude to God, we send our requests, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgivings that are made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. There's almost too much to count that we can give thanks for. All of our material blessings, the privilege of having been made children of God and heirs of heaven through Jesus Christ, for living in a nation where we can gather freely in worship. These are all gifts that we receive and continue to enjoy. And thanks and praise is due our God in Christ Jesus. As God healed the 10 lepers, he also gives you good gifts. He heals you of your sin. He gives you in return for your disobedience eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. As we cry out, O Lord God, have mercy on us, we receive that which we most desperately need. And we answer with the psalm, O give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. We give thanks today and every day as we journey through this life, on the road to eternal life. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the gathering of the offering. We rise and sing the Te Deum.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, we adore you as the God and Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus, and with all the whole church on earth and all the hosts in heaven, we ascribe to you honor and blessing, thanksgiving and praise. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord God Almighty. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. You created us in your own image and redeemed us with the precious blood of your Son. By your Spirit, you sanctified us and called us out of darkness into your marvelous light. Grant that we may, with thankful hearts, receive these great mercies and express our gratitude, not only with our lips, but also in our lives, as we give ourselves to your service and walk before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Deliver us from sin and error, from the frailties of the flesh, the allurements of this present age, and the temptations of the devil. Give us faith that works in hope and love. Give us hope that never disappoints, kindness that never fails, confidence in you that never wavers, patience that does not grow weary, and courage always ready to confess Jesus Christ our Lord, that we may live in your mercy and die in your peace. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. We sing hymn 596. rise for prayer. Merciful God, we humbly implore you to cast the bright beams of your light upon your church, that we, being instructed by the doctrine of the blessed apostles, may walk in the light of your faith and finally attain to the light of everlasting life. Grant us, O Lord, wisdom that comes down from above, that your word may not be bound, but have recourse to be preached to the joy and edifying of Christ's people on earth. Grant this, Lord, for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. O Lord, our Heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, you safely brought us to the beginning of this day. Defend us in the same with your mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings, being ordered by your governance, may be righteous in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Our closing hymn is number 825.